शुरू में मैं इस पूरा नौजवान ऑडियंस को धन्यवाद देता हूं कि आप लोगों ने मेरे को ये मौका दिया आप लोगों के बीच में बात रखने के लिए। मैं अंग्रेजी में बोलूं तो चलेगा? चलेगा। So as Krishna has told you that we are living in a country, as Professor Prabhakar Sinha has also just mentioned before you, that we are living in a country where there is widespread injustice among the people. I want to bring certain specific examples of this injustice before you, relating to certain specific areas in which I am specially interested. But before we do that, I would like to look at the phenomenon of injustice in the Indian society in a more general light. Along with injustice goes violence. Injustice cannot be maintained in society without the use of violence. Man is naturally a just animal. It is a natural part of our visions of society that there should be justice in those societies. We naturally try to bring about justice in any society which we try to construct. So the phenomenon of injustice is not something that is maintained on its own. कि चलो अपने आप से जो अन्याय है वो चलता रहता है, ऐसे नहीं है। अन्याय के पीछे ताकत रहती है। अन्याय को बरकरार रखने के लिए कुछ लोग, कुछ इंस्टीट्यूशंस, कुछ फोर्सेस ऐसे होते हैं विच कीप दैट इनजस्टिस इन प्लेस बिकॉज इट इज टू देयर बेनिफिट। एंड इंडियन द हिस्ट्री ऑफ इंडिया सिंस इंडिपेंडेंस इज एन एग्जाम्पल। I wish to bring before you certain specific examples of the way in which injustice has been maintained in Indian society. Firstly, look at the phenomenon of violence. In Indian society, state-based violence is a generalized phenomenon. We think we are living in a peaceful society because the kind of background from which we come, the kind of societies from which we come, the kind of families from which we come are not affected in general by the violence with which injustice is maintained in this society. But there are large sections of the Indian population which are subjected constantly to violence that is based on the power of the state. There are areas of this country which are constantly affected by violence. There are sections of the population, Dalits, scheduled tribes, certain specific religious communities, which are constantly affected by violence. India has been an independent sovereign nation since 1947, 65 years. In those 65 years, there has not been a single year in which specific sections of the Indian population have not been subjected to the violence of the state. This is is something that we must realize. Our vision of patriotism, our vision of our nation, our vision of our country, when we think of our country, this should also, this idea of violence maintaining specific examples of injustice, must form part of the patriotism to which we subscribe. When we think of our country, when we think of our nation, we feel proud about certain things, but we should also realize that there are sections of the Indian population which are continuously being subjected to violence, and which have been subjected to violence. Some part of the other of the Indian population has been subjected to violence, one form of violence or the other, every year since the time we have attained independence up to today. There are other speakers who would be telling you about specific examples of that violence. I will tell you about some examples of that violence. But when we talk about human rights, then that is the violence to which we address ourselves. Because we believe those people who are working for human rights believe that violence is not a good way to run a society. That violence is something that we must avoid. And the way to avoid violence is to have a just society. Where justice prevails, violence is reduced. So the way to have violence, if you look at the directive principles of state policy enshrined in our constitution, I'm sure all of you are so well educated, you must be knowing about the constitution. You must be having at least some idea of the structure of the constitution. In the constitution, there are certain injunctions to the state. There are certain instructions issued to the state on how we should run the state according to the ideas of the people who wrote the constitution. And in that, in the directive principles of state policy, one of the important principles is that all state activity must be directed at the elimination, at the reduction of economic equality. Even if you can't at one step make the society which is economically just, but still it is the duty of the state, it is the duty of all those who are involved in running the state to constantly strive to bring about a society which is more just tomorrow than it was yesterday. This is the duty enjoined on us by the Constitution. But instead of that, what we have, particularly what we have since 1991, when a policy decision was made to implement globalization and liberalization programs, was that we should, that it is legitimate. It is a legitimate strategy to ensure growth, to encourage inequality in society. So if you look at this policy and the legitimacy of this policy in the light of this constitution, the entire government and the entire state of India have been engaged in an unconstitutional activity since 1991.